Let's talk now about linear phase filters. Linear phase filters. Yeah, so what are linear phase filters? What's the motivation? So our motivation comes from the following aspect here. So remember, our FIR filters are essentially just a delay line. And then we've got our impulse response here. Yeah, so this was here our x of n, this is our y of n, and this is here our summation node. And this was here our impulse response. So for example, we could retrieve or generate this impulse response from an analog system. Yeah, so we could just take our analog system here and turn this into an H of N. Yeah, so the question is now, so are there any filters, any FIR filters, which are better than analog filters? And they are. So we can generate FIR filters which cannot be so easily implemented as analog filters. And that's a great advantage here. So let's write this here again. So linear phase filters because in the digital domain we can create so-called linear phase filters. Yeah, linear phase filters, what does it mean? So it means that the group delay is constant. So that our tau g is constant. Yeah, so this means that all frequencies are delayed by the same time. Yeah, so in this case is tau g. So in the analog domain, analog filters, this is a so-called Bessel filter. But the problem is, in analog domain, this can be only usually approximated, so it's never perfect. And it has a couple of other difficulties like bad stop band rejection and other problems. So can we create something which is by definition always linear phase? Yeah, so can we create FIR filters? So can we construct FIR filters which are always linear phase. So this linear phase. So this goes down to so-called constraints. So we need to find constraints. Constraints on the impulse response. So we'll see that these constraints are quite flexible. And so what you need to do now is essentially deriving these constraints now analytically. So in the next step, let's derive them now. Derive them analytically. So what are the requirements for constant group delay? So we want to have tau of omega should be constant. Yeah, so that's our requirement. So we know that this is calculated as, so tau is calculated as, so our group delay here. So tau of omega is calculated as minus d phi and then of omega divided by omega. And remember this one here, this was our arc of, so the argument or the angle of h to e to j omega. So in other words, we need to construct an h of e to j omega with constant group delay. Yeah. So let's construct an h of e to j omega with constant group delay. And then after this, we just do a inverse Fourier transform. And so this, we are retrieving then the impulse response. Impulse response with constant group delay. So how does a function h of e to j omega look like with constant group delay? So h of e to j omega with constant group delay. This is easy to construct, so let's define this like e to j omega and then have a b of omega. So this is here real. So remember, similar to our cosine term we had in this frequency response of this averaging filter. And then we multiply this with a phase factor here, e to j omega tau, and then plus j phi. So this obviously is our complex phasor or complex phase. So then the arc of h of e to j omega is just this one here. So omega tau minus omega tau and plus phi, this angle phi here. Okay, so now we know that the group delay is just a derivative of that. Yeah, so if we call this here theta of omega, so then theta of omega, and therefore of that the derivative negative here, then this obviously just gives us here on this side here minus tau. So this means we see already by construction, so this has a constant group delay. So we can basically tick that. So in the next step now, we just need to do the inverse Fourier transform. So let's write down our function again here. So e to j omega. So this is our definition of b of omega, and then multiplied, we've got our e to minus j omega tau plus j phi. So we know that this frequency response here has a constant group delay. So has constant group delay. So what we would like to have now, we would like to get our impulse response out of this. So you would like to get the impulse response to determine the constraints so that we have constant group delay. So what needs to be done? We just obviously do the inverse Fourier transform. One might now think, why don't we do the inverse Laplace transform here? We don't do the inverse Laplace transform because the inverse Laplace transform is virtually impossible to calculate. So we just go to the using the inverse Fourier transform here, just with the risk that we may be getting a causal time series out of that. But this is much easier to calculate. Yeah, so we don't use the inverse Laplace because that's just too difficult and too cumbersome to calculate, whereas the inverse Fourier transform is so easy to calculate, and we're dealing with a causal problems then later. Let's do now our inverse Fourier transform. So h of n is 1 over 2 pi minus pi to plus pi, then h of e to j omega here, e to j omega n, d omega here. Remember, we are in sample domain, so it only runs to from minus pi to plus pi. So now we just need to substitute our b into that here. So 1 over 2 pi. And then our b of omega here, that's our real part, and then we've got the e2 minus j omega tau plus j phi, and then our e2 j omega n d omega here. So what we do now, we merge these two here, and so this one is a it's just a phase factor here. So we can move that to the front. And then the other two we just merge together here. So let's do that. So B of omega here. And now we need to be careful here. But we have here E2 minus J omega tau. And then we've got this term here, and this is here minus N D omega. Yeah, so minus minus gives plus here. That we have this one here, we've got the negative tau term from there, and now we've forgotten the phase factor here, which is E2 J phi. So that's sitting here. So now we've got here this term here. So now what we would like to have is essentially again a Fourier transform here. So just now what is a bit annoying here is this tau here. So this one here. So we would like to move this tau out here out of this transform, and then what we would have left here if we are able to move this out here out of this term here, we have just a normal Fourier transform. So the aim here is normal Fourier transform. Okay, so let's do that. Let's just move this here out. So let's just write this down here again. So we have H of N, and then we've got our phase factor here E2 J phi divided by 2 pi. And then the integration is from minus pi to plus pi here. And then we've got our B of omega here. And then we've got here E2 J omega N minus tau D omega. Okay, so now what we would like to do is we just move this here now to the front. So we have, what we would like to have is basically an N plus tau. So we just move the tau in here. So then we have E2 J phi divided by 2 pi minus pi plus pi. So this stays here B of omega. E2 J omega N D omega. Yeah, so just by moving this here out. That was a bit of German in there. So just by moving this here out. So now what we have here is, this is essentially B of N. That's the inverse Fourier transform of B of omega. So this gives us then H of N plus tau equals E2 J phi divided by 2 pi multiplied by B of N. So that's already quite a nice closed form here. So now the problem is this B of N, we don't know the B of N, so we would like to eliminate the B of N. So how do we do that? Let's just write this down here again, thus we have this on this page here. H of N plus tau is E2 J phi divided by 2 pi, and then this is here multiplied by B of N. Or if we solve this for B of N, then we're getting here, then we've got here the H of n plus tau multiplied by 2 pi, and then the exponential here turns in e to minus j phi, so like this. Okay, so now we have just also just solved this here for b of n. So remember, we would like to now eliminate b of n. Yeah, so this one here. So how can we eliminate b of n? So what we need is essentially a second equation here of this one. So we need to have a similar equation like this one here. And then we could just substitute b in it. So now remember, to rescue comes here that b of omega, so our function is real. And so this means, remember, if we have a real frequency spectrum here, then what results out of this here is that b of n is equals to the complex conjugate of b star of minus n. Yeah, so we've got this symmetry condition. So this is essentially here the mirror. So before, we always had the mirror in the frequency spectrum, but this also works the other way around. So if b of omega is real, we've got this equivalence relation here. So therefore, we can also write h of n plus tau equals to e to j phi divided by 2 pi, what we have here, but as b star minus n. Yeah, so the same idea, but now the complex conjugate here. And so now it's obviously easy. We're just equating these two functions here, and with this we are eliminating the b. We just need to turn this complex b here into complex conjugate b into a normal b, and then we're able to equate these two functions here. So let's do that. Okay, so we have been left with this here. So n, so b complex conjugate minus n equals to e to minus j phi, and then 2 pi h of n plus tau. So in the first step here, what we do is we're getting rid of this negative sign here. So we just move the negative sign in here. Yeah, so we write b star of n, this is e to minus j phi 2 pi h of, and then tau minus n. So the next step is just doing the complex conjugate of this here. This is also pretty straightforward. So complex conjugate of the phasor is just that we're rotating it the other way around. And then 2 pi, and we have got the complex conjugate now of our impulse response. So tau minus n. So that's with this one also sorted. So now remember, from our previous page, we had the other condition b of n was, what was it, 2 pi, and then e to minus j phi, and then this was h of, and then here just tau plus n. So pretty much the same, only here different signs, and then this is here just with a negative sign, and here that's a positive sign. So now we just equate these two ones. these two functions here, and with that we are just getting then e to j phi 2 pi h star tau minus n equals 2, and then 2 pi e2 minus j phi h of tau plus n. So then obviously the 2 pi here cancels out, and then we can also move this here over here to make it look a bit nicer. So e2 2j phi h star tau minus n equals 2h of tau plus n. So like that. So let's write this down here again, just that we have our result. So e2j phi, and then this here h of star tau minus n equals 2h of tau plus n. So this is our final result here. So now remember, why we did this here. So we wanted to have a constraint on the impulse response. So do we have that? So if we analyze this function now here, so we've got here, this is our sample number. And so this one is here in positive, running in positive time. And this one is here running in negative time. So this means we have something like a symmetry condition here. So the H star must be identical of this here running positive and negative time. And this tau here looks like a shift operator. Shift. Yeah, so this tau just shifts the whole, so this function h in time. So now what is a bit more tricky here is this factor here. Yeah, so that's a factor which, depending on the angle phi, can create us all different kinds of complex numbers or real numbers here. So here we can create any complex phase. Okay, so we need to deal with this complex issue here a bit more, and also with this complex conjugate here. Okay, so we have forgotten or ignored so far another requirement. So let's just discuss this here further. So our h of tau minus n and h of tau plus n, yeah, so these are impulse responses, yeah. But in general, we would like to have some real. So this means, oh yeah, forgotten the star here. So this means that essentially, you know, H star is identical to H, because the complex component is zero. So we would like to keep basically both sides real. So if this one is real, we also would like to have this one real. So now, if we are writing down our or equation here again, so e to 2j phi, and then h star of tau minus n, and then this is here h of tau plus n. Then, so if this one we would like to have a real, and this one we would like to have a real, then obviously here this term should also stay real. Yeah, needs to be real. So and the real values we are getting out here, if this is just a phasor which is rotating around here, so that's real and this is imaginary, then the only two values which are on the real axis here, this is 1 and minus 1. So these are the two values which are only allowed. So and therefore we can replace this term here just with plus minus 1. Yeah, so that this here is plus minus 1. So this means that the whole function here is just plus minus h in this one. Okay, so now once we have derived this relationship here, so now we can develop a graphical representation of that. So now we've distilled this down to a pretty simple function, and now we're also dropping the complex conjugate because it's real. So h of tau plus n. So what does it mean? So again, this tau is something like a shift operator. So imagine this is your tau, and this means that around tau this function needs to be symmetrical. Yeah, so this function, for example, needs to look like that. Yeah, so we need to have symmetry. So if this is here our h of n, so we need to have then essentially here symmetry around this time tau here. However, what is also possible is, so imagine we have again tau here, and we have a function which might look like this. This doesn't look very symmetrical, but let's assume it is symmetrical, that we have essentially here something like a anti-symmetric function. For example, this could be here something like a cosine, and this here could be something like a sine wave. As long as it's symmetrical or anti-symmetrical, then if this condition is here fulfilled, then the system is linear phase. So this is here our condition for linear phase. Yeah, so the impulse response, needs to be isosymmetrical. Or antisymmetrical. And that's obviously a very, very simple result at the end. So as long as we have symmetrical or antisymmetrical impulse responses, our system is always linear phase.